It is Saturday. So did you all take a moment this morning to think about Saturn? No, didn't occur to you. It is Saturn's day. Saturn was a pretty important figure for a long time to many people all around the world, not always called Saturn. To the Greeks, he was Cronus. And, of course, in the beginning, they say that Uranus, heaven, and Gaia, earth, were husband and wife, and so closely embraced there was no room in the world. And Cronus was born to them, and with a scythe, he cut them asunder so that Uranus was sent spinning far, far, far away as the planet that carries his name to this day. And Gaia remained here to care for her children, and they say that was the beginning of time. And it's sometimes considered that Cronus is still with us in our words for time, like chronology, chronicle, chronometer, chronic. Perhaps if heaven and earth ever come back together again, we will know the end of time. Well, we don't often think about that, though, as we go through our days. These days, Saturn's day. Tomorrow, Sun day. Of course, Moon day. Those are pretty obvious. Tuesday, Tuesday. That comes from the Anglo-Saxon. We recognize it maybe through the French Mar day, right? It's Mars day. And hence, Fat Tuesday is known as Mardi Gras, right? Fat Mars Day. Wednesday is Odin's Day, Odin's Day. That one-eyed, all-seeing father of the Norse pantheon. Thursday is Thor's Day. And Thor is still a very popular figure with us today. Maybe some of you are familiar with the movies about Thor that have been on the screens recently. Friday is Freya's Day, the goddess known to the Latins, to the Romans as Venus, the Greeks as Aphrodite, and to the Sumerians as Inanna. But we don't think about those things every day, do we? We have their names with us as we go through our days and in our calendars, but we don't say, hey, let's meet on Freya's Day. That's a good day to talk about the goddess. We say, oh, it's Monday. It's a good day for us to think about her, the moon and what phase the moon is in. We don't necessarily, we just carry those names with us. They are with us like a kind of forgotten ghost. And yet, by carrying forward their names in a way, we propitiate them unknowingly. That which was before us is still before us. And our lives and times are a kind of palimpsest of writing, etched over writing, etched over writing, etched over writing in endless layers deep down to some inchoate beginning. Next weekend, I'm going off to Albuquerque, New Mexico, to the Electric Universe Conference there, where a variety of scientists from many disciplines are coming together to discuss plasma cosmology, and that is the role of electricity throughout the cosmos, the universe, and also here on Earth, and even within our own human body, from a microcosmic scale to a macrocosmic scale, looking at the concept that electricity plays a very important and vital role, perhaps even more powerfully than gravity, in the coordination and the maintenance of the universe. Very simply put, think of the light bulbs here in the room, right? Each of them sheds light, but each of them is integrated to a network of power, of electricity that is flowing to them from great distances from our power plant, for example, right? And they're suggesting now that the sun is like a light bulb. It is receiving and sending energy throughout a network of plasma filaments across the universe. A concept that you can find in mythology and say, Indra's net, a great net of jewels, all shimmering and shining, but all bound together and all reflecting off of one another. One of the things that's being looked at is the historical record that we find in mythology and that we see etched into petroglyphs and rock art all around the world, where they find repeatedly similar repetitive symbols, great circles, great spirals, and also great rising columns. Sometimes referred to as a chain of arrows, like a stack of mountains, or a great Christmas tree, and we find that shape repeated throughout our own human history. I was just recently in China, and I went to the Temple of Heaven in Beijing, and there it is, the great rising layered cake of Mesopotamia and the pyramids of Egypt, and a lot of places. That's the palimpsest, right? Some deep imprint that is still beneath the modern scene that we're part of, but is a part of what's informing from within our history and from beneath the ground, right? And in our background, that which was before us is still before us. And so Dovey was making some very interesting observations, and I was thinking about some of those deep layers from the past. And she mentioned, for example, in the Iroquois tradition that the women have to make a lot of the decisions and frequently are in a role of leadership, except in times of war, when then sometimes a war council is convened and then the men are in charge of managing the affairs of war. Well, that happened to be the same tradition in the Fertile Crescent in Mesopotamia for thousands of years, where the goddess was the reigning deity, and therefore the leaders were the women. The queens were also at the same time priestesses, so they had a kind of a holy role on earth, and their kings were what today would be the queen's position or the first lady's position. They were a supportive mortal mate, right? But the kings only came into power when it was in a time of war. In times of war, the men were put forward as the leaders. But there's a tricky thing about that. If you feel disempowered and you only get power at a time of something like war, and you want to hold on to power, then you have an incentive to continue to make war. This is the civilization that is at the root of Western culture. Something worth pondering about how it maybe came to pass that we saw a transition in which the king rose and the queen was diminished in terms of her status, and we had a series of warrior kings throughout our Western history. But that aside, I want to share with you another story that I'm inspired by the great oak that you have here. Dudley was talking about the council oak. I was thinking about these beautiful oak trees that we have here, and that story of the separation of heaven and earth and how Cronos cut heaven from earth and started time. Well, if you go all the way around the world to the other side, almost directly the opposite side from where the story of Cronos was told, you come to New Zealand. And the Maori there tell a very similar story. They say, long ago, heaven that, no, the head is down there, and the feet are up here. And when we look at the trees, what we see above the ground is mirrored by a network of roots beneath the ground. There is as much below the ground as there is above the ground. But what we're seeing above the ground is from the waist to the toes. What's below the ground is from the waist to the head. If you think about it, the fruit-bearing part of the tree, just like the fruit-bearing part of our bodies, is below our waist. It's up there in the branches of the tree, right? And so, you know, Tane is reminding us, too, in terms of thinking about how we relate to the earth, it might be useful for us to turn our heads around. There's a story that comes from the Greeks that Ovid recounts in his Metamorphoses that also carries with it a consideration of the trees. But again, because it comes from the Greeks, I think you'll hear how it is in the lineage of Kronos. See, in a green age, long before us, after Kronos sighed the heavens, before Orpheus stopped singing, there was a king named Erisichthon, strong and proud and wealthy, made his riches mining metals, digging quarries, milling timber. Erisichthon wanted greatness, so he planned to build a palace, a great monument of feasting, entertainment, and carousing, a hall of excess and indulgence. So, in the forest, he went searching for the wood to build his palace, or the hard wood everlasting to fulfill his life's ambition. And the forest fell beneath him as he cut into the darkness, and he severed from the mother the green giants of her valley, and he carted off that timber to his mills beside the river, whose deep waters he diverted for the turning of the mill wheel, for the cutting of the green wood. But still, he was not happy, for he wanted better timber, larger lumber for his working, for the arch and beams and trusses, for the uprights and the framing, for the lattice and the inlay. So he kept his cutting forays, while the earth beneath him trembled, and the beast about him bellowed, and the fowl screamed from the heavens. Still he kept at taking timber, till he came before the oak tree. Leagues around as high as heaven, the stars above turned on its axis, the earth beneath spun like a discus, and in his grove grew ash and aspen, birch and cedar, shaggy redwood, scented lilac, apple, pear and peach, paduke and pine, for this was the great tree at the center, sacred child of Demeter, who appeared before him, pleading that he turn away from harming, that he stay his hand from cutting what was numinous and sacred. But Erisichthon, filled with lust for his great plan, pushed past the earthly goddess, and with thunder in the valley, he attacked the sacred oak tree, spilling blood from its deep gashes. Red lice blood flowed in the forest, and when he cut across its center, that tree's falling scarred the heavens. Then he carted off that timber to complete his building palace. Drinking deep at his long tables, while his drums beat out a rhythm to his power at his pleasure. But the goddess, unforgiving, called her sister to his chamber. Foul famine came upon him and embraced him in his slumber, wrapped her legs about his belly, licked the salt off of his forehead, drawing sustenance out of him and replacing it with hunger, leaving appetite unceasing. Famine came and kissed and cursed him. And in the morning, ravenous with hunger, Erisichthon ran out screaming, calling for someone to feed him. Come and bring him many plates, many platters, many foods, many dishes for his hunger, for his appetite, uneasing, unceasing, unabating. And his servants worked all hours, cooking, boiling, roasting, baking, roasting, toasting, making dishes. dishes after dishes, always bringing to him platters. Everyone he fell upon with eating and devouring, not a crumb escaped his notice, and he dropped and splashed, and even he fall upon the laughing, more a beast than something human. Yet still he suffered hunger, with no ease and no abating, and soon his larder was depleted, so he traded his possession for more meat and grain to feed on, 100 head of cattle, 1,000 pecks and bushels gone as soon as they were gotten. And still he suffered hunger. So he studied how to treat it, how to have his cake and eat it. And then he thought about his daughter, one loving and devoted, innocent, caring person that was left to him. He decided to exploit her, and he sold her into slavery to furnish funds to feed his furnace. But still he suffered hunger with no ease, no abating. And soon it all was lost him. All his pride and power fallen. And he wandered as a beggar, eating filth amidst the ruins of the world he had exploited. Until at last, his hunger in his belly, like a mad wolf in the winter, howling in his belly, gnawing at him, endless, made a madness in his head. And he turned his greed upon himself. And to himself, he fed himself. In a number of ways. When he went to his beautiful roses to enjoy the rose garden, and they turned to gold, sense, Midas was in the pocket of Bacchus. And, when they were asked, when they came to him and asked him to judge a musical contest between them, between the wind and the pipes and the strings and the harp, Midas simply favored the one who he owed a favor to, right? The god who had given him the touch and had taken it away. And because of this, Apollo, seeing that this was an unfair, vested interest kind of action on the part of a political leader sort of thing, sometimes happens, I guess, depending on how much campaign contributions you receive, you know, you have a certain sort of slant or bias, if you will. Well, Midas had that bias, and Apollo saw that that was the case, and so he said, you did not listen with true ears, you only listened with your obligations. Your ears are not suited for music, they are the ears of an ass. And immediately out of his ears grew long asses, hairy ears, right, donkey's ears, an image that we see actually repeated again in the story of Pinocchio, maybe, or in the story of Midsummer Night's Dream. And so Midas, though, being a king, knew that he couldn't rule if he was shown to be an ass. So he fashioned a comical cap to put over his head to tuck those ears into. Now mind you, this is a story being told by the Greeks, not by the Phrygians. The Phrygian cap was actually a symbol of liberty, and they had, one of the world's first republics, and that's why they wore those caps. But for the Greeks, it was their conical caps hiding the ass's ears of the king, because they certainly didn't respect them very much for their policies. But that being that aside, Midas, hiding his folly, tried to continue ruling as best as he could, but those ears tucked under that hat itched him, troubled him, worried him, and they grew hairier and hairier and became more and more uncomfortable, and he knew he had to do something about it. He had to get there. So he called the royal barber into his chamber, and there in privacy, he made the barber swear allegiance and swear secrecy to what he was going to see. And then he removed the cap and revealed these great ass's ears. The barber was shocked by what he saw, but he did his best to shave and trim and get rid of the discomfort for the king, who then tucked those ears back under his cap. But you know how hard it is to hold a secret. That secret burned and troubled him within, and he just couldn't, you know. I could, but I finally it was just too much. Bohemia means the home of the boy. The boy were a far-flung branch of the Celtic diaspora. They were as far out as northeastern Mediterranean lands, so northern Italy all the way into Greece, perhaps even northern Turkey. So I've decided, and I've told my son Nick this, that we are related to Homer. And it's in our blood that we should be itinerants, because it's in our name, as part of our story. Right, always be the new man, always be the newcomer, and that we have storytelling in our blood. Now, I can't claim as much of legitimacy as perhaps Dudley can, who can trace their lineage a little bit more authentically, but one has to sometimes, if you're new in the world, if you're a newcomer, sometimes you have to write your own story. Well, the stories then of the world for a wanderer become like other people's domains that one rides along the fences of, you know. So Novak is sort of a fence rider, and I'm often looking in through the windows of other story traditions and other homes and whatnot, and taking from them those elements and ideas and stories that I can use to make sense of my own life and maybe to pass them on to others as I go, just the way that any wayfaring stranger might do. When I was a boy growing up in South Florida, we had a wonderful little story village where I could receive some of my very first stories. It was an attraction, a family attraction called Storyland. And Storyland was a little storybook village in the middle of woods. You had to go down through a trail of slash pines to come into this village, and there in the center was a commons, and there was a pedestal with a candlestick. And every now and then, Jackie Nimble, Jackie Quick would run and jump and do acrobatics over the candlestick. And there was a petting corral where Mary had a little lamb and Bo Peep her sheep. There was a great gray whale with his mouth agape and sharp teeth and a long tongue. And if you were brave enough to walk past those teeth and into its belly, you would find Pinocchio and Geppetto playing checkers. There was a house of straw, a house of sticks, and a house of bricks, right? And you know, the pigs lived there. And then there was a great pumpkin coach, and then there was a giant pink shoe, and there was an old woman who lived in that shoe, and with all of us kids didn't know what to do. You could go into the shoe with a door in the heel. You could climb up and slide off the toe of the shoe. It was great fun and a love story. But I was growing up. And in time, I sort of put away childish things. I had other things to pay attention to. My dad was in the aerospace industry. It was the space race in those days. My mom was a science teacher. So our gaze turned heavenward. We became lunatics, right, in the true sense of the word, because we had moon madness. We were all looking at the possibility of landing a man on the moon. And it was as if our stories went with our gaze, because then the most popular form of fantasy fiction became science fiction. And all of the fairy tales moved up to inhabit the heavens and the stars. And they lost their home on Earth, in a sense. But years later, as a teenager, my brother and I were exploring through the canals of South Florida, and we were in a boat, and we were off on an adventure, and we came to a little muddy patch of land, and we went off exploring into a sand of slash pines, looking to see what we might find, always wary of snakes and alligators, hoping we actually might see some, but not knowing what we would do if we did. But as we were working our way off the shore, we began to come across some pop charts, some little bits of archaeological ancient evidence, you know. And we thought, well, okay, maybe there's an ancient civilization here, some pre-Columbian outpost of the Aztecs or a Mayan temple or something like that. But we keep following these clues, it'll lead us in a trail to some great discovery. Perhaps even the fountain of youth that Ponce de Leon, who named the state Florida, the land of Floridas, spent his life searching for and never found. Maybe we could find it. Well, we came through the pines, and we came to a clearing where there were high grasses and that sleigh bell sound of crickets in the midday heat, and there were little bits of decaying timbers of wood and weathered pieces of stone, and we realized we had come across some lost civilization, but we didn't know really what we had found until the sun illuminated a giant pink shoe. Finally, the door in the heel rusted off its hinges. Then we not a place for gentle souls. That day she watched the flames go up, as to the funeral pyre her father fed her mother's linens tainted with disease, her mother's spinning wheels, and anything that by her mother had been touched or held, so that she said, "Now, father, throw me in." For often mother held me in her arms, sang me songs, and taught me to be good, and told me not to fear, all would be well. Her father's only answer was to grunt, and drag her mother's oaken chest outside, but she said, "Stop! Do not this burn, not this. This is my hope, my only hope, now that my mother's gone. My mother gave this chest to me before she fell, before the scarlet rash began to spread." "If you would have it, keep it," then he said, "and let it be your dowry if you wed." He said no more, but turned and went inside as if he had disposed himself of her. But she remained beside the fire and wept. "Now I am all alone and dispossessed, an orphan of the living and the dead." And in her mother's voice, she murmured low, "Bye bye, baby Bunty, daddy's gone a hunting, gone to fetch a rabbit skin to wrap this baby Bunty in." And sitting in this way, while still she wept, she curled up on the ground and slept. Her father went away and left her there. He had many dealings at the court and many ships of cargo in his care, goods to move to market from the port. Beside her mother's ashes, she remained and would not enter in her father's house. And many times the moon did wax and wane and still look down upon the lonely girl. And the birds and other creatures of the fields regarded her as one as wild as they, and tentative as wild creatures are, adopted her, and taught her how to live, to gather seeds and roots and hazelnuts, to make a nest of rushes and of leaves. Her mother's chest she hid within the woods and covered it with mistletoe and moss, with ivy vines and holly sprigs. And in that place she'd often sing out loud the songs her mother used to sing to her. "Wash hands, wash, daddy's gone to plow. If you want your hands washed, better wash them now. Clap hands, clap, daddy's coming home, 'cause daddy has money and mommy has none." One day, a horse-drawn carriage came in view, and as she watched, it stopped beside her father's house. Her father had returned and brought with him a woman stepping in her mother's place, a widow with two daughters of her own. And when they saw her standing in the soot, her tattered garment stained with ash and tears, they laughed and said, "Oh, father, who is this? Is she a peasant or some stable wench?" Her father, seeming not to know her, said, "She is an orphan girl I pity for her mother's sake." "An orphan girl," they said, "a cinder girl, a girl in rags and ashes. Oh, father, let her cook and clean for us, and comb our hair, and tend our fireplace." "If it amuses you, my dears," he said, "then we can let her sleep beside the fire." And after that, they called her Cinder Girl. Now, the sisters did not know that she was king. They did not care or think of her at all, except as someone they could boss about. And when they watched her foraging for food, for seeds and roots, which was her custom then, they laughed and threw their porridge in the dirt. "Now forage that, you silly cinder girl. Peas porridge hot, peas porridge cold, peas porridge in the dirt 9 days old." The cinder girl was good and kind to them. But they were ladies who had been to court, and she knew nothing of the world beyond. One day, a rider came to them with news that they were all invited to a ball. The prince decided it was time to wed and wanted every lady in the land to come present herself before the royal court. Oh, then there was excitement in that house. Their wealthy father lavished gifts on them, the latest laces, satin, silks, brocades, corsets, buns, and hoops, and petticoats, and shoes with pointed toes and stilted heels. His second wife, her daughters, took in hand to make sure that they were fit to meet this prince. And in this frenzy fitting, Cinder Girl was set to iron all their clothes, to sew their hems, to mend their hose, to wait on every wish and whim as if they were already princesses. She helped them lace their heavy corsets round their waist, to one of such simplicity, so unaffected, showing no pretense. When Cinder Girl saw him, she was surprised. She thought he'd be commanding and aloof. Instead, she saw a man inside a mask, a royal mask of pomp and circumstance, but in his eyes, she saw another man. A man who was in hiding, like herself. And for that reason, when they met, she sang, "Oh, that I could be where I would be, then would I be where I'm not? But where I am is where I must be, and where I would be, I cannot." This prompted him to step aside to her. "Fair lady, who are you? What is your name?" Instead of answering, she asked of him, "Well, who are you beneath your golden crown?" "I am a prince," said he. "Oh, no, not so," said she. "You are a man. You walk upon the ground as others do." This gave him pause. It seems to me that we are merely toys for some almighty player up above. Our happiness, our sorrows, but a muse, some unseen eye, some strange divinity. When I agreed to have this ball tonight, I had no way of knowing what I'd find. The thought of doing nothing frightened me, for nothing comes of nothing, it is said. So I agreed to have this masquerade. And here we are. And here stand you and I at midnight on the threshold of the day. And in this moment, I am filled with feelings rich and strange and wonder at our meeting in this way, for you are fair, more fair than any she had ever seen or heard described. And in this instant, I would give my life if I could spend it only by your side. To his abrupt confession, she replied, "A pearl set in a golden brooch is fair, but is it fair when lying in the dirt? Are pearls prized for beauty in themselves, or only when they fit in fashion's mold?" Said he, "I know your beauty anywhere." Said she, "Let's try and see if that is true. Now close your eyes for me and turn around 3 times. While you do this for me, I'll sing for you." He did as she requested, and she sang. Blind man, sure you can't see. Turn round 3 times, try to catch me. Turn east, turn west, catch me if you can. Do you think you can find me, blind, blind man?" He opened up his eyes, but she was gone. Chimes of midnight ringing in the dark. He searched throughout the castle, but found none to tell him who she was, where she went. He watched the partiers depart, but saw no hint of her he lost. Disconsolate, he sat upon the stairs until the morning light began to break. In the morning light, he saw a gleam of something golden on the bottom stair. There was a golden slipper lying there. And like a miner digging in the dark upon the point of giving up his quest, who finds a bit of gold stuck in the wall, takes hope from that, and starts his quest again, just so the prince took up the golden shoe, determined that he find the owner's foot, and so find her who had eluded him. And all the while that he was doing this, a girl in rags and ashes stood nearby. She watched him mount his horse and ride away, and wondered if his quest would help him see. He searched throughout the land, and last of all, he brought the golden slipper to her father's house. Outside the window, Cinder Girl observed the prince present the father with the golden shoe. "Does this belong to any maiden here?" The father took the golden shoe and said, "This is the garment of a woman gone." "I know that," said the prince. "That's why I'm here." "Well, the one who last Now take my daughter with you and be wed, and let